pathology at Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. At the outset, I am extremely grateful and thankful to Pakistan Society of Hepatology, ably led by Professor Kashif Malik and his team. The topic which has been allotted to me is non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis, controversies in diagnosis and management. Portal hypertension is defined as an entity in which there is increase in the portal pressure beyond a reading of 10 mm. So whenever the portal pressure is more than 10 mm, this is called portal hypertension. Traditionally, we are so used to... Hello? Traditionally...
Go ahead. We can hear you.
Okay. Traditionally, we are so used to seeing patients with portal hypertension, and for all practical purposes, this is synonymous with cirrhosis of the liver. But then we should not forget that there is an entity called non-cirrhotic portal hypertension. That means you may have portal hypertension with a normal functioning liver. Now, this non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis can occur because of the problems which may lie ahead of the liver, that is pre-hepatic lesion within the liver, hepatic problem, and then occurring after the exit from the liver, that is post-hepatic causes. Common pre-hepatic causes include extrahepatic portal vein obstruction, splenic vein thrombosis, and splenic arteriovenous fistula, whereas the typical hepatic causes including pre-sinusoidal sinusoidal and post-sinusoidal portal hypertension, and subsequently you have post-hepatic causes. That means obstruction of the outflow tract of the liver beyond hepatic vein, which is typically right-sided heart failure, constrictive pericarditis, or severe tricuspid regurgitation. What today concerns us is the hepatic causes of portal hypertension. This could be pre-sinusoidal, sinusoidal, and post-sinusoidal. In pre-sinusoidal, the commonest causes including non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis and cystosomiasis, which is a common problem in the Egypt, whereas in sinusoidal causes, even in the absence of the cirrhosis, you may have alcoholic hepatitis as one of the important reasons. In post-sinusoidal causes, you have veno-occlusive disease and Budd-Chiari syndrome as cause of raised portal pressure. Today's topic is non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis. I'm going to tell you what is known about it and what are the controversies. What is definitely known about it, that is a disease of uncertain etiology. It is characterized by periportal fibrosis. There is an involvement of the small and the medium branches of the portal vein, leading to the development of the portal hypertension. By default, the liver function and the structure, they tend to remain normal. So I think there are students in the gathering, it is an important lesson for them to know that in case of a normal preserved liver architecture and function, if you still have portal hypertension and variceal bleeding, do think of NCPF as a cause. But what is debatable about NCPF is etiopathogenesis. Is it infective in origin? Does it relate to the exposure to the trace metals and chemicals? Is it a part of immunologic and immunogenetic problem? Does it occur because of the underlying or overlying prothrombotic state? Or do we have a unifying hypothesis which tends to club all different components into one basket presenting as NCPF? Let's see what this amounts to be. In fact, we know that there is a precipitating event like infection, trauma, or a thrombotic event. In a patient who is predisposed genetically, either because of the prothrombotic predisposition or because of the genetically acquired or acquired prothrombotic predisposition. So two types of problem can occur. So you can have a severe problem occurring at birth, progressive, mainly involving the portal vein. That is called extrahepatic portal vein obstruction. You may have a mild problem recurring, presenting late in the childhood or early adolescence, presenting as portal vein hypertension without blockage of the portal vein. That is non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis. The basic difference is rapidity of onset, the acuteness of the problem, the involvement of the major veins versus the involvement of the small and the medium branches within the portal vein with the intact portal vein, which is dilated in NCPF. So there is a dual hypothesis. Most of us do believe that there is something occurring within the medium and the small branches of the intrahepatic portal veins, either because of the infection in a patient who has a prothrombotic state coupled with immunological problem. All these things, all they conspire together to lead to blockage of the portal vein, which is called obliterative phlebopathy, or else there may be a mechanism in which the problem starts within the endothelial cells of the portal venous radicals. They produce a lot of TGF-beta, which leads to stimulation of the myofibril-like cells, leading to the deposition of the fibrous tissue in and around the portal vein, the portal venous radical, leading to obstructive portal vasculopathy. So infective hypothesis typically occurs in poor country like yours and ours, in which umbilical sepsis is an important component, in which we all know that the umbilical vein retrogradely drains into the left part of the portal vein. So if there is a, during childbirth, when you try to sever the cord from the placenta, if the hygienic conditions are not maintained, there is a retrograde spread of the infection from the vitelline duct or to the left portal vein, leading to the portal pyemia, portal pyelophlebitis, resulting in thrombosis, sclerosis, and obstruction of the various parts of the portal venous system. In fact, especially from India, Dr. Guha Majumdar's group, I'm sure senior colleague of Pakistan Society of Hepatology must be remembering, Dr. Guha Majumdar did propagate a theory of arsenic poisoning as a contaminant and the source of infection in patients who have NCPA, but subsequently there was no proof of that. There was also a publication from Dr. Sareen which showed that if you look at the water content in patients who have NCPF in that particular locality, and also in my studies, there was a direct correlation between the arsenic toxicity and development of non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis. In fact, in both in the pediatric age group as well in adults, you have various prothrombotic state which have a definite association with development of the extrahepatic portal vein obstruction or NCPF. This is a publication from Dr. Yacha's group from SGPGI Lucknow, in which 14 out of the 19 patients who presented to them with extrahepatic portal vein obstruction did have one or the two abnormalities related to the prothrombotic state. This is a publication from Japan which clearly showed that about 1/5 of the patients in their series, this is a series of extrahepatic portal vein obstruction in adults, every 5th individual was found to have some mutational change in one of the prothrombotic genes, which is known to get precipitated in a scenario like this. So the basic difference between two causes of non-cirrhotic portal hypertension is NCPF and EHPVO. As I've already mentioned, if you have a chronic smoldering disease because of the persistent antigenemia, leading to the microthrombosis and phlebosclerosis of the medium and the small branches of the portal vein, resulting in pre-sinusoidal portal hypertension, that is NCPF. But if you have a severe infection starting in the early childhood, maybe at birth, leading to the occlusion of the main portal vein, resulting in portal vein formation, obliteration, and replacement by cavernoma, this is called extrahepatic portal hypertension. In NCPF in India, we have multiple series published from almost all parts of India. You look at the breakup, it is a male predominant disease, typically occurs in the age group of 29 to 30 years and leading to development of portal hypertension. Pathologically, liver is a small in patients who have a nodular type of NCPF. There is a progression of the portal hypertension in late stages of NCPF, resulting in so-called nodular non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis. But typically in NCPF, liver is supposed to be normal and you have involvement of the portal venous radical. If you look at the pathophysiology of portal hypertension in patients with pre-sinusoidal, sinusoidal and post-sinusoidal portal hypertension, you have normal portal vein. This is a normal hepatic vein, and hence the sinusoidal pressure is not high. In patients with NCPF, you have raised pressure in the pre-sinusoidal region. So you have a normal hepatic venous pressure with raised hepatic venous wedge pressure. So there is no difference between the two. So to distinguish between a cirrhosis and NCPF, you have to bank upon hemodynamic study. And if wedged hepatic venous pressure is normal or is slightly elevated, that is diagnostic of NCPF. Whereas all of us know that if you have to diagnose portal hypertension in cirrhosis, you have to have a raised wedged hepatic venous pressure. We are doing routine measurement of HPVG in our center. And whenever there is a doubt or distinction between child's ACE cirrhosis and NCVF, you have to fall back upon hemodynamic studies by measuring the HPVG to give a correct diagnosis. As mentioned earlier, most of these patients being in the male predominant state, they tend to present with features of repeated GI bleeding, long-standing hepatomegaly, and in the late stages, they may come back with the ascites or jaundice as a part of nodular NCPF. Basic difference between NCPF and EHPVO are that all those who are having EHPVO, if they are destined to bleed, they will do so within the age of 20 years. Whereas the mean age of bleeding in patients with NCPF is 31 years. So it's almost a decade later. Most of the patients with NCPF have male predominance, and portal bilopathy and portal gastropathy are far more common in EHPVO than in NCPF. So younger age group, higher incidence of portal bilopathy and portal gastropathy, more likely that you're talking of EHPVO versus NCPF. Endoscopically, typically shows large varices. Larger the varices, more likely that NCPF is the cause of portal hypertension rather than cirrhosis. In fact, larger varices and anorectal varices are more likely to have problems in NCPF than in patients who have cirrhosis of the liver. Diagnosis is made by good quality ultrasonography, including Doppler studies. And at times, if there is a doubt, you can fall back upon angiography for confirmation of the site of the lesion and the degree of the collateralization of the blocked components. For looking at the specific etiology, you may have to do the specific anticoagulation, procoagulation test to look at the cause of genetic abnormalities. Differential diagnosis include child's ACE cirrhosis, acute and chronic EHPVO of procoagulant varieties, and tropical splenomegaly syndrome, which is typically becoming less and less common, at least in our scenario. This is the basic summary of the differences between the three. Early age group, you have EHPVO, non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis. Middle age group, cirrhosis will typically occur at 40 plus age. All patients with EHPVO and NCPF will continue to be stable after bleeding, whereas ascites will come after the development of bleeding in patients with cirrhosis of the liver. Portal bilopathy is far more common in EHPVO than in patients with cirrhosis of the liver. Variceal bleeding in patients with NCPF is managed in exactly the same way as we do in patients with the cirrhosis of the liver, except that if you have to talk of tips, it cannot be done for the reasons of logistics, because there is no portal vein which can be connected to the hepatic veins. And hence, shunt surgery may be an answer in patients with a failure of endotherapy. Hypersplenism tends to occur in 40 to 8% of the patient, is more common in patients with larger spleen, and it may be one of the reasons, large spleen and hypersplenism may be one of the reasons why patient may have to undergo surgery. In a country like ours and yours, where patient with repeated variceal bleeding, especially if they come from a semi-urban or a rural area, may not have access to the good quality endotherapy, and hence shunt surgery, at least in NCPF, may be the answer of treatment of choice, not only for prevention of hemorrhage, but also for taking care of the splenomegaly, correction of the bilirubin abnormalities, and also for acceleration of the growth in the children. Prognosis is very good. If you look at the outcome of the patient, 5-year survival in NCPF is almost 100%, which is unheard of in patients who are bleeding following cirrhosis of the liver. In fact, after shunt surgery, you have 88% 5-year patency of the shunt with routine use of anticoagulants. To sum up, ladies and gentlemen, extrahepatic portal vein obstruction and NCPF are important causes of portal hypertension in India and the Asian Pacific region. Their prevalence and incidence is coming down, possibly because of increasing prosperity in this region and increasing the overall hygienic standard. Recurrent pyelophlebitis resulting in obstruction of either the intra or extrahepatic portal venous system in a genetically predisposed individual results in this entity called pre-sinusoidal portal hypertension. If you have a one-time major block of the portal vein in a young boy up to the age of 20 years, that is extrahepatic portal vein obstruction, but at the age of 30 years, if you have recurrent small obstruction to the medium and small branches of the portal venous radicals, then that is called NCPF. Most of these patients tend to have recurrent variceal bleeding without decompensation. That is clue to the diagnosis. The diagnosis is made classically by simple diagnosis with ultrasonography with the help of Doppler studies, which will show the reversal of the flow and the blockage of the portal vein, further confirmed by CT angiography. Recurrent variceal bleeding is managed in exactly the same way as we do it in cirrhosis of the liver. Gastric and rectal varices are far more common than in cirrhosis because of the very high pressure being available in the portal venous system. Shunt surgery for symptomatic hypersplenism, recalcitrant GI bleeding, and retardation of the growth, especially in EHPVO, are very good answers for patients with presinusoidal portal hypertension. Portal biliopathy is a unique entity in EHPVO, and left alone, all these patients with increasing age will develop portal biliopathy. Overall prognosis, luckily for ourselves and our patient, is much better than in patient with portal hypertension related to the liver and post-liver causal like Budd-Chiari syndrome.